Living things have managed to eke out an existence just about everywhere. From wood frogs who freeze themselves to survive winter, to the creatures that live right next to hydrothermal vents at the bottom of the ocean. They all have mutations that let them survive in some truly hostile places. In the immortal words of Dr. Ian Malcolm, life, finds a way. And you might not think of humans as being in the same extreme adaptation boat, but we also call a lot of places home, not all of which are exactly easy to live in. So here are six groups of people with impressive human adaptations. Before we get started, you might be wondering how these different abilities came about. They're what geneticists call local adaptations. These are physiological differences stemming from some kind of change in the genetic code that became more and more widespread over time because they gave people living there some kind of edge. Usually this happens early in that population's history, when they settle in a new place. We're talking tens of thousands of years ago. Anything from being better at digesting certain foods to dealing with the intense UV from the sun, we're all superpowered in our own way. But there are some traits that are especially cool. We're going to start way up in the clouds with populations that thrive at high altitude. For most people, trekking anywhere higher than around 2,500 meters above sea level will start to cause some serious problems, from nausea and fatigue to vision problems and trouble sleeping, especially if you ascend too quickly. There's just not enough oxygen for most of us to supply all our tissues with what they need. Go up really high or climb there too quickly, and your blood vessels can narrow due to the lack of oxygen, causing fluids to build up in your lungs or brain. But it's not just low oxygen that's a problem here. Food is limited and it can get pretty cold. Yet somewhere around 81 million people live more than 2,500 meters above sea level and do just fine. Different groups of people have done this in different places too. That includes the Andean people of the Andes Mountains and Tibetan people of the Himalayas, some of whom live at altitudes of more than 4,000 meters. And while both groups have larger lungs than the lower altitude normies, each of them ended up developing different physiological ways of dealing with the same problem of low oxygen. Tibetans have several different genetic mutations that allow them to use the little food available more efficiently. Basically, their metabolisms are fine-tuned so they get the absolute most out of every bite. On the other hand, Andeans have changes in their DST gene, which seems to control how their heart muscles form, at least in mice. And in the Andeans, it's related to having larger right ventricles and higher overall blood pressure, so they're able to pump oxygen around their bodies better by having their hearts work a little harder. Interestingly, Tibetans and Andeans have different concentrations of the oxygen-carrying protein hemoglobin. Andeans have a relatively higher concentration than lower altitude populations, but Tibetans actually have a lower concentration. Tibetans make up for it with a mutation in the EPAS1 gene, which codes for a protein that turns on hundreds of other genes that help use that hemoglobin more efficiently. And it turns out a subset of Andeans, the Quechua people, also have a version of this gene. Unlike other Andeans, Quechua people have low hemoglobin levels like the Tibetans. They're kind of their own little subpopulation living high up in the Andes, so they've been partially genetically isolated from other Andean people for long enough for their genetics to do their own thing. And what's really neat is that Tibetans and Andean Quechua people evolved this mutation separately at different times. And at least for the Tibetans, they got this mutation from another species. Genetic analysis suggests they inherited their version of EPAS1 from the Denisovans, somewhere between 30 and 50,000 years ago. On the other hand, Andeans probably developed the mutations some 20,000 years later when they first started living in the Andes. It just shows if there's a good solution to a problem, evolution will run with it. Speaking of tough places to live, can you imagine spending your summers lounging outdoors in 0 degrees Celsius and your winters huddled up at minus 45? Yeah, that is not my cup of tea. And it's not for most people either. Since extreme cold means we start losing heat faster than we can make or keep it, and our organs don't work as well as they should. Eventually, if we're too cold for too long, those organs shut down. Yet, for several groups of indigenous Siberians, the cold never bothered them anyway, thanks to a bunch of useful mutations. For one, they can do something that animals who hibernate in the winter do, called non-shivering thermogenesis. This lets their body fat make its own heat instead of just working as an energy reserve. That ability is thanks to the UCP1 gene, which works inside the mitochondria to switch from energy-making mode to heat-making. And UCP1 has a partner called the UCP3 gene, which is correlated to colder living, although it isn't fully clear exactly what it does. A second supergene called PRKG1 is involved in the muscles that line our blood vessels, constricting the vessels to slow heat loss. And since the cold can cause blood pressure to rise, this gene also seems to help their hearts deal with the extra pressure. But cold isn't the only thing they have to contend with. The foods that are available in Siberia are pretty fatty, so if you or I were to try the Siberia diet, we'd probably end up with high cholesterol. But Siberians have variants of the CPT1A and LRP5 genes, which together help them digest that super fatty food and keep cholesterol in check. So in the face of some truly hostile environments, indigenous Siberians can stay cool as cucumbers. These next people managed to take extreme survival to a whole new level, specifically below sea level. There's a group of South Korean women famed for diving underwater all day long without any gear. They're known as the Hanyo, which literally translates to women of the sea. Since 503 CE, this group of women have been freediving to harvest abalone, octopus, and various seafoods off Jeju Island, South Korea. When most people dive underwater, we trigger something called the dive reflex, where our heart rate slows down to try and conserve oxygen, and blood is redirected to the vital organs. That's not necessarily a bad thing, unless you're pregnant. See, Hanyo dive even when they're pregnant, and it's possible that triggering the dive reflex while expecting could lead to a dangerous condition called preeclampsia. Preeclampsia raises the pregnant person's blood pressure way too high, which can be fatal for both them and their baby. But that doesn't seem to happen to Hanyo, and a study from 2025 might explain why. When regular participants simulated a dive, their diastolic blood pressure jumped, and while that was true for the Hanyo divers too, their diastolic pressure was higher than the non-Hanyo participants even before they hit the water. The researchers suggest that having their diastolic blood pressure cranked to 11 may end up allowing their bodies to tolerate those spikes better. Scientists think that it's because of changes in the expression of a gene called FC-gamma-R2A, which might dampen the downsides of high blood pressure by tempering inflammation of the blood vessels. What's cool too is that it wasn't just the divers who had this genetic mutation. All residents of the island did, even if their family members weren't divers. The mutation must have spread throughout the Jeju population, which settled some 10,000 years ago. So even if you're not directly affected by some environmental pressure, you might still benefit from it. Win-win. Before we get to our next superpowered population, here's a quick ad break. Thank you for watching SciShow. Right now, you're getting all of this cool science knowledge for free, and we want to keep it that way. So we're holding the second annual Complexly Learnathon. It's a month-long celebration of learning and the free content we make here at SciShow, Crash Course, and all of Complexly. Now's the time to get some limited edition merch and join us across our channels for classes and behind-the-scenes peeks. Plus, you can participate in fun stuff, like a TTRPG game featuring some people from the SciShow team. We need your support to help us, real people, make real videos and fight AI slop. Go to complexlylearnathon.com to join in. While diving is one really useful adaptation for island living, there are other adaptations that came from some of the other challenges of living on island time year-round. A big one is food. There's only so much that you can grow on a limited landmass, so finding enough to eat is a challenge. That's exactly the problem early Samoans faced as they settled on new islands in the Pacific. In 2016, researchers from Samoa and the US found a gene mutation in Samoans that increases fat storage and dials down metabolism. The gene, called CREBRF, also protects against cell death that's brought on by starvation. So if food was scarce, early Samoans probably wouldn't go as hungry, since their bodies were better at extracting and storing nutrients from the little food that was there. And even if they did, their bodies would be somewhat protected from wasting away. Unfortunately, there's a downside. These days, food access isn't as much of an issue, so these genes that work to store as much energy as possible have a lot more calories to work with, and the gene is is now correlated with higher risk of obesity among indigenous Samoans. That doesn't mean that all Samoans are destined to be obese. Genes are just one part of the picture, and diet and exercise still play a major role. Just goes to show that hand-me-downs from our ancestors aren't always useful in the modern day. So most of these other adaptations have been about surviving stuff related to your geography. But this next group of people has managed to pull a move right out of Wesley's playbook in The Princess Bride and developed a resistance to poison. Instead of iocane powder, some Argentinian people can drink arsenic. See, there's some places where the only potable groundwater also comes with a high dose of arsenic, which includes areas in Argentina. Arsenic is linked with a bunch of cancers, lung and heart disease, heart attacks, and developmental problems in babies. The World Health Organization says the safe limit of arsenic exposure is 10 micrograms per liter of water, but there are some people in Argentina who are exposed to over 5 times that amount. Fortunately, certain Argentinians have a genetic mutation that protects them against this constant barrage of arsenic. One study looking at genetic adaptations in women found that those living in San Antonio de los Cobres in northern Argentina had slight differences near a gene called AS3MT. This gene is involved in turning arsenic into a less toxic form through a process called methylation. So people with the gene are better at breaking down the toxin. Researchers think that the first steps toward this variant were probably there when people settled in Argentina and were strongly selected for in areas where arsenic concentrations were high. They call this fast and widespread a selective sweep, and it might be what happened for other mutations on our list too, like the diving abilities of Hanyo or the calorie thriftiness of Samoans. Which makes sense. If everyone else around you is dropping dead of arsenic poisoning, it'd track that anyone who had a leg up against the poisonous groundwater would be pretty popular. So there may still be a market for that old Victorian arsenic wallpaper after all. Now, we've talked about how evolution can find many different solutions to the same problem. Well, this last group of people on our list takes that to the next level, with at least 4 different strategies against one of the most common diseases in the region, malaria. Malaria is common in Africa, and the World Health Organization estimates that the continent carries 94% of all cases worldwide. It's caused by 1 of 5 species of Plasmodium parasites, almost always carried by a mosquito, that initially sets up camp in the liver, but later spreads to the red blood cells in the bloodstream. Malaria infections cause fever, chills, abdominal, muscle or joint pain, and cough. But if left untreated for too long, the parasite-filled blood cells can block blood vessels to the brain, causing brain damage or organ failure, which is as bad as it sounds. But people in some of the areas of Africa with the most incidences of malaria have developed protections against it. One of these is as simple as having the right blood type. In some parts of Central and Western Africa, nearly 60% of people have type O blood. And while researchers knew type O blood was protective against really bad cases of malaria, they've only recently started to understand how that works. Blood groups are classified based on how antigens sit on the surface of a cell, like little hairs sticking up off the surface. So different blood types react differently to the stuff around them, like proteins. The O group is protective against malaria because it helps prevent that clumping of red blood cells I mentioned earlier. Remember, you need double copies of that gene to have type O blood, and if you have just one copy of an A or B gene, that's your blood type, which is why you can have upward of 99% of people with the variant, but far fewer people we'd call type O. So your blood cells are better off without the A and B antigens when it comes to malaria, and you might be better off without other common red blood cell antigens too. A 2017 study looked into the prevalence of another antigen group, the Duffy group. The Duffy blood types are also called A and B, which is super helpful and extremely clear. But instead of an O for no antigens, we have type null. Anyway, the study found that virtually everyone they looked at from sub-Saharan Africa was missing the Duffy A and Duffy B antigens, so virtually everyone's Duffy type is null. The study also found that most people in Asia have Duffy type B, and in Europe, there's a decent split between A and B, but no populations outside of Africa have the majority type null, which could mean that fewer red blood cell antigens of any type are just better for preventing malaria. Another mutation scientists have known about for a while is a combination of alleles called HBAS, also called sickle cell trait. Since they have one copy of the sickle gene and one for standard blood cells, they have a combination of blood cell shapes, both sickled and round. Having this gene combo might protect against malaria in a couple of ways. For one, researchers think the body breaks down those sickle cells more quickly, which gets rid of the parasite that's infecting those cells. This also means that the parasite ends up present in the body at non-lethal levels for a lot longer, which could give the immune system more time to mount a response. Then there are the other adaptations against malaria. A 2012 study of Ghanaians found a change in the ATP2B4 gene, which codes for the main calcium pump of red blood cells that controls several cell functions. Changes in this gene could mess with the delicate chemical balance in the cell and also mess with how the malaria parasite matures and reproduces inside it. That same study found another mutation on the chromosome 16q22.2. Part of this chromosome codes for a protein called MARVL-D3, which is found in the lining of blood vessels. This altered protein might help prevent diseased red blood cells from sticking to blood vessel walls and blocking them up, or it might change how much inflammation those cells can cause in the vessels. Malaria is still a big problem, especially in Africa, largely due to poverty and drug resistance. But it's amazing to think about how our species' genetics have been fighting it for thousands of years, well before we could bring out the big pharmaceutical guns. Thanks to our desire to go where no one else has gone before, our ancestors managed to develop some pretty creative solutions to some really hostile situations. With each new place, new challenges have come that have shaped our genetic code and made for some pretty cool mutations. It just shows that we can do just about anything we set our minds and genes to. Just don't try any of this at home. Especially the arsenic one.